Итак, добрый день, дамы и господа.
So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for agreeing to take part in this discussion. We have two topics for discussion: Russia after and Europe after Cyprus, and what may become the catalyst of growth in Russia and Europe, and if such catalyst is possible at all in the current situation. This is the second day of our forum. We are full of impressions and opinions that have been expressed during the discussions in these days, and all we have to do is just a little bit of summing up of what has been done and said. The events in Cyprus that took place about a month ago have determined the tone and the mood and the mode of today's discussions. Let me introduce the participants of today's discussion, and I will start from my far end. Lev Pargotsky, a former Minister of Culture of Sweden, thank you for coming. Екатерина Новокрещёная, Senior Vice President of Moscow Exchange, thank you. Михаил Шамолин, Chairman of AFK Система. Александр Базаров, Member of the Board of the Sberbank of Russia, thank you for coming. And Oleg Tinkov, Chairman of the Board of Directors of Tinkov Credit Systems, thank you for joining us. As I've already said, the night on March 16th, when the Council of Ministers and of Ministers of Finance of the European Union made a decision to reduce aid to Cyprus and suggested that Cyprus should look for ways to cope with the situation, by way of probably charging a one-time tax on the depositors. I think this will definitely be a part of the global economy and global financial system. The most important thing is trust or confidence. Will we be able to maintain trust in the existing situation, and how will the events may develop in the coming days or years? So, how the changed rules of the game affected you, your behavior, your perception? I stick to rather a pragmatic or even cynical approach. De facto, such country as Cyprus has become bankrupt. And of course, it could have been saved, and we could have discussed the amount of savings package. But the European Union, given its own interests, they looked at the countries, they estimated the scope of disaster and what will be the aftermath on the European currency if the country goes bankrupt. They concluded that the impact will be insignificant. And they pragmatically and cynically decided not to help the country out and let it resolve its problems by itself. So all the money in the Cypriot banks, if Cyprus went bankrupt, will be lost. But so if any company goes bankrupt, if it cannot support its balance and it's short of money, the creditor come and take all the money on the account. So 100% of what was there could not be taken from a company or Cyprus as a country. So it's a very much similar situation. You can see a political pretext of the situation, but I think it was pragmatism that prevailed. What's the sense of paying the money of the European and German, per se, taxpayers to save our country on the faraway island? So you look at this decision as pragmatic, but the emotional factor was very strong and influenced the further decisions and mood of the investors, macroeconomists. Alexander Vladimirovich, please join us. I'm here. I joined you. I'm sitting next to you. One of the main lessons that we can draw, that the experts advise us, don't keep your money in the banks. because there is no reliable banks, period. The system itself is unreliable. I agree partially in a part. That's the right advice. Just don't keep your money in the banks. Keep it in Sberbank. Well, the second part of your conclusion is that that there are no reliable banks. Sberbank is as reliable as the Russian Federation is, as reliable as our civilization or our universe. The scenario where the civilization collapses, Sberbank will probably experience certain difficulties, but we will cope with them. To be serious, I would say the after effect of what has happened in Cyprus is difficult to estimate or perceive. Trust is created by hard work during many years, and it's lost immediately. Of course, Cyprus will not be able to get to the point where it was prior to March 14th, but to foresee how the events develop is very difficult, because we do not know what kind of decision has been made. And we definitely know that this decision doesn't fit the standard framework of understanding, because there was no bankruptcy of the banks. It was a very strange procedure which has not been described or prescribed anywhere, and it definitely negatively affects the clients. We see the inflow of clients' money to Sberbank's accounts in Russia and abroad, and you know that Russia's Sberbank is present in the almost 30 countries, we estimate that that east flow is about hundreds of millions of dollars. So what's the fundamentals of this decision? Was it pragmatic, nearsighted decision? Could you suspect that the finance ministers of Europe made a decision not even understanding the reaction of the investors or banks' clients? Well, I will probably join Mikhail in his opinion. I think there is no conspiracy here. I think simply Cyprus didn't have a win-win solution. It was a choice between the bad and a very bad solution of the problem. So what I don't know whether what we have here there is whether it's a good better of the bad solutions or it's the worst of the bad solutions, but in all the banks, in all the companies, in all the banks all over the country, problems, and on the families all over the world, problems start when they are in short of money. Mr. Tinkoff, what's your opinion about the conspiracy theories and the fact of presence of the Russian money in Cyprus? As a businessman, what were your feelings about it, that the decision was made just because there was a lot of Russian money in the island? Is that what's your feeling about it? It's difficult for me to judge. I don't follow the events in Cyprus. I never kept money in Cyprus, and the same applies to my company. Tinkoff Credit System is an active player in the debt market. Every quarter we place Eurobonds and other instruments, debt instruments, in US dollars and euros. And from in the amount of from $50 to $300 million, and as a rule, when we collect the money, we deposit it in Sberbank. It's a true fact. It's a matter of fact. The first incorporated company, the first Eurobond that we had was in 2006. It was 60 million euros in Laiki Bank back in year 2006. That's a story. That's history. I keep all my money with the Russian banks, in my own bank and some other Russian banks. I think Cyprus is a positive story from the viewpoint that people start understanding, they learn that the evident thing that there is nothing more reliable than the Russian banks. So the government guarantees up to 700,000 rubles in deposit. Then you can call a manager and demand your million of dollars if you have it. Objectively, there are only Swiss and Russian banks which are most reliable in the world. In America, your account will be arrested if you do something wrong in connection with Magnitsky Bank, Magnitsky provision. In Europe, they just claim that they are regulating something. They regulate nothing. And I'm convinced that the Central Bank of the Russian Federation does regulate the situation. We tend to complain about Russia, but I would tell you right away that the Central Bank of the Russian Federation controls and regulates the Russian banking system more professionally and in a more centralized way, in a better quality way than that in Europe. I do not understand the people who keep their money abroad. They're strange people for me. To sum up what Alex says, the best place to keep money, we have Sberbank in Switzerland. It's a double reliability, double robustness. Keep your money in Sberbank Switzerland. What are the criteria of reliability of the banking system, and what criteria affect your decision in addition to the insurance of your deposit, 700,000 rubles in case that the money will be paid back to the depositor in case of crisis? Well, I have my personal understanding of the processes underway in the country. I do not understand the process, let's say, in Austria or Cyprus. I understand what's going on in Russia. I understand that the market is very firm and stable. I'm very comfortable with this feeling. We know people. I do not need to necessarily call Graf with my question, but I can call Natasha, my manager with the bank. So the Russian banks are very profitable. They last year they made 1 trillion of rubles net. It's an enormous sum of money. If you look at the net interest margin of European or even American banks, they do not make a lot of money. That's the key approach for me. Look at the bank and look how much does it make. If we look at Sberbank, it makes 10-15 billion of dollars net profit every year. You can keep your $1 million with Sberbank. There's no point of keeping your money with Laiki Bank, which loses money every quarter. You don't need to be a nuclear physicist to understand the situation. Keep your money in the organizations which are profitable. I see that there is a reaction to your comments. As you are planning to you're planning to leave this hall soon. So what's your attitude toward possible offshore zone in Russia, and suggestions regarding the offshore the tax amnesty in Russia? I don't need a tax amnesty in the country where the profits are taxed at 13%. I don't understand the people who are trying to avoid paying taxes in Russia. That's totally useless. I like the initiative of Shuvalov. He wants to set order from the viewpoint of Russian legislation, so that you could incorporate your trusts here. Why all we businessmen need all those Cypresses and BVIs? If there is a law for Russia to become a wonderful place to keep your money, it is already one. but it's still not a good place for incorporating your companies. Why Cyprus? Because it's the English law. We have the shareholders of Goldman Sachs and Baring Vostok. And it's not possible to do it according to the Russian legislation. It's not just possible to have a shareholders agreement according to the Russian law.
In this regard, Shuvalov is personally going back, which may be good. It would be a good incentive to change the situation. The more politicians go back to Russia trying to change the legal framework, the better we're all off. Because we don't need those Dutch or Cyprus offshores. After all, a disclosure will be there at any moment if any public prosecutor demands that. So that's a silly situation. Corporations should be incorporated in Russia. No offshores are needed in Russia because taxes are the lowest in Russia for individuals or corporations. Companies do not pay much comparing with Europe. We have one problem, the way I understand it, in this puzzle. We lack good legal acts to make it happen. There are good, reliable banks. There are understandable legal framework tax-wise, quite good taxes provided. And the final thing that is missing is legal acts to regulate shareholder agreements and whatever disputes. If that is put to right order, there will be an avalanche of people coming back to Russia and people coming from the West, because holding money in any Western jurisdiction or Western bank, that is just dangerous in my view. Thank you. Thank you, Oleg Yurievich. I'd like very much Mr. Bagrotsky to give his comment on everything you heard. Mr. Bagrotsky, do you have a lot of money and do you have any portion of it in Russian banks? Thank you.
Well, not yet, but after having heard so much about Sberbank, maybe I should change my mind. But as everybody now is using TV time to broadcast some free commercials, may I say that Swedish banks are the safest on this planet, even safer than the Swiss ones, because we don't have that kind of agreements with the United States. Let me, as I am the only one here who is from an EU country, let me say something about the EU politics about Cyprus. I don't believe in any conspiracy. I think it is a very simple thing. Angela Merkel, who decides about these things, she is up for elections, and if she mobilized German taxpayers' money to bail out people with $1 million in cash or $1 million in liquid wealth, she would be fired by her voters. It's as simple as that. And she lives in a country where this is a reality. She faces unhappy voters that think that they work hard all day long to pay money to EU that passes them on to lazy and rich people. She must demonstrate that somebody else, somewhere else, suffers pain if she wants German taxpayers to pay and vote and continue to vote for her. And then the Cyprus government was obviously in chaos. One week they wanted it one way, and the second week they wanted it some other way, and it demonstrated to the entire world that EU policymaking is in shambles. One week small depositors are asked to pay, next week small depositors are not asked to pay. The EU deposit insurance scheme is wiped out through the window and has no credibility whatsoever anymore. So now depositors must choose where to have their money in a more active way. And I think a lot of money will leave some European banks, some Spanish banks, French banks, and maybe even German banks. And Cyprus is finished. Cyprus built its wealth on tax evasion, on a reputation of good financial regulation, and that turned out to be false. They tried to get the Lebanese banking business when Lebanon was in civil war. They tried to get the Yugoslavian banking business when there were wars there. and now it will all disappear. And they will be back to tourism. It demonstrates, I think, to other countries with fantasy names, Virgin Islands, Bahamas, Cayman Islands, wherever you are, that their money, their wealth is not safe. Depositors must turn back. And in Russia, as the legal framework improves, I think the reasons for moving outside the country and with the low tax rates, the money will come back.
Thank you, but the idea of comparing the advantages of the Swedish or Russian financial systems, that's a very lucrative perspective, because the place in the sun, the new Cyprus, could be a position that many people would like to compete for. I'm only interested to know, if you don't have an agreement with the United States like Switzerland has, but if Sweden were to accept similar financial flows that Cyprus had had, would the Swedish government surrender, not disclosing the bank secrecy, if that is necessary?
I don't think that would be very good for Sweden. Why should we attract that money? I mean, a too big financial sector causes more risks than assets. I mean, we talk here in a financial industry context where financial industry wants to grow and make more money. But from a national point of view, the financial sector causes instability. And this is not a source only of wealth. It's also a source of shocks, of instability, of unemployment, of inflation, of exchange crisis. That's the experience of Sweden. And why should we try to be even more in that risk zone than we were before? I mean, we can make a good living out of our own normal business. We don't need to attract these hyperfluid flows. Actually, I'm afraid of too much money flowing into Sweden, because that would risk appreciating the exchange rate and cause unemployment in our industry.
That's the example that people know well how to learn from other people's mistakes. Ekaterina, you did have an opportunity to know expert opinions about Russia's investment appeal and Russia's view of international investors when you were doing the MI6 roadshow during the IPO. Could you share some conclusions of yours, please? Quite frankly, the conclusions are not very nice sounding, not only at the stage of the roadshow. We were lucky. We did that when the markets tended to be quite positive. The markets were going up. But the most disappointing experience came afterwards. Like, we were meeting with investors for 2 days, even at this forum, and many sad things were said about the Russian market and Russian prospects. Maybe they're right, at least partially. Hence your second question about what is the internal source of growth? In my view, that's what needs to be taken good care of, because the downward trend of energy prices could be very significant for Russia and a threatening factor for Russia, and that's important. There's important to be looking for alternative sources of creating value now. And what was mentioned about the offshore zone or tax amnesty, that sounds as a fantasy, I'm afraid, saying that this country's budget can allow any kind of tax breaks, which I doubt very much, what with all the social obligations. But if some money could be spent on growth stimulation in certain sectors, then I think in this country, the most important thing is to stimulate small and medium-sized businesses. Not so much with tax measures, but much was said about it even yesterday. What we need to do is change the climate and change the attitude to many things, not even at the legislative level, because laws can be perfect. The main thing, if there is a level playing ground at court, if you are a strong or a weak one, maybe that happens 100 years from now. But Russian courts have been in existence for a long period. This is quite a young country so far, or quite a young nation, and some political convention is required. that, for instance, in this country, the interests of minority shareholders are not to be touched, and any court that goes against the best interests and legal, lawful interests of a minority shareholder could feel the threat. If we need to conduct any national policy, we need to have a national policy for creating the bourgeois class, because what with the fall of the energy prices, looming ahead for us will be low fiscal opportunities and high unemployment. We need to have a class of bourgeois in this country. And Mikhail was speaking yesterday about Russian mentality here, and that is a real problem there, because many people inside have the desire to take other people's wealth and divide it equally. We need to have the class of petty bourgeois, small businessmen en masse in this country. That's what we must have. Mikhail Valerievich, would you like to second that or to continue? You're not medium or small business, but if it was you who spoke about the mentality in a bright way yesterday, well, this is a second topic, growth catalysts, how we can reset the growth or find the growth, yes. What I think is, I'm convinced, that's a matter of politics, not technology. It's a choice between socialism, whatever form it may take, and capitalism. And what we actually need, what Europe needs to have now, much more of capitalism and much less of socialism. Actually, what they need to do in Europe is what Margaret Thatcher used to do in Britain, reducing social benefits, conducting privatization, make the rules more stringent, and making the people earn money rather than getting them more or less for free or on privileged conditions from the state. That's a situation where a nation has an income tax at 50% or 60%, and then the tram driver in Greece be paid 80,000 euros per year, like it happened in Greece. That's nonsense. That's just nonsense. And that's not the way for the people to understand how the world is built. That's a global problem indeed, and people have some disliking to capitalism, but socialism is that you can divide only what was earned before, and once there is nothing else to divide, socialism must come to an end. Why people keep talking about Germany and German pensioners, about them financing Cyprus? That's only because Germany is the most best performing economy in Europe, of the highest labor productivity, more capitalistic country than their neighbors. Southern Europe are more, much more socialist countries where people prefer not to work. And just quite often, they have some ideology behind that. Like in Portugal, when they're giving an interview to a TV, why don't you care to take a job? People say, why? We have a very good climate, we have a long siesta, we want to live our full life, we don't want to work at all. But that cannot exist. Either you work and your economy grows, or you don't work and your economy, actually, when you run out of debt money, you have to pay your bills, so there is no money, you go broke, that's it. That's only a fair way for everybody. And that's exactly the period we are living through, because it's been a long time, 25 to 30 years. Lately, when we saw the country debts growing with many, many countries in the European Union, Russia has an advantage there because our debt to GDP is only 10% now. But something must be done to the debts, accumulated debts. And the only thing that is possible to do is improving performance, reducing the debts, more of capitalism. Mr. Bagrotsky, what do you say about that?
Well, I say that it feels like this was an airing of a lot of prejudices about socialism and capitalism that does not hold for reality. In Greece, they have lower taxes than Germany. They have longer work weeks than Germany. Sweden has higher taxes than all of them, and higher GDP per capita, lower public debt, bigger surplus on the current account. the numbers just do not support those value-based statements that you just said. I mean, what system people choose for creating flexibility, dynamism, innovation varies, and there is no cheap trick like just cutting taxes and things will move by themselves. In that case, Greece would be extremely successful. Also, Greece has the largest number in Europe of small enterprises. That is also usually used in Europe as a sign of success. You need more small enterprises, small entrepreneurs in order to create success. Well, Greece and Portugal are the two countries in Europe with the largest number of entrepreneurs. And the smallest number of entrepreneurs are Norway and Luxembourg, the two richest countries in Europe. So, I mean, it's not as simple as it sometimes sounds. Thank you.
But I actually want to sort of advocate what Mikhail said.
По-русски, потому что мы в прямом эфире.
Я хочу поддержать Михаила в данном вопросе.
I'd like to support what Mikhail said. We didn't mean so much reducing taxes, because, like, in this country, the tax burden is not unwieldy. Instead, on the contrary, I said that tax breaks would not remedy the situation, but I meant reduction of social benefits. Mikhail talked about that vis-a-vis Europe. I meant Russia, because I know Russia more, better than I know Europe. And the problem is a quite of generic matter. Socialism can be found in both places. We have not finally gone over to capitalism. People do not know how to feel personal responsibility for their personal wealth. They rather try to build a career at some large state-owned corporation so as to be wealthy and healthy for a long time. And in Europe, they have played with socialism for long. Sweden had a very good model of socialism, but it is not to be replicated by everybody else. Michael Yulis has a very good study. He traveled around all crises stricken by the crisis, Greece, Ireland, Germany, US, looking for reasons of the crisis in the national mentality, why the Greeks went to demonstration, having while the Irish just had no political change and political turmoil. But that was a lengthy, and that is a lengthy study, a lengthy talk about that indeed.
In Ireland, the old government was, the entire party was wiped out, but they did not march the streets. They had a civil war recently, maybe that had something to do with it. But my argument was with Mikhail, who used different European countries and compared them according to this socialist scale, and I just tried to say that he may have some points somewhere, but the overall picture was entirely and fundamentally wrong. But as I said, high tax countries can be very successful, low tax countries can be extreme failures. And I don't think that's, I did not talk about Russia because I don't know enough in this distinguished panel to stick my neck out on Russian economics or politics.
To complete this discussion, just a brief comment for 2 minutes. A lot depends on the mindset of people and the social nature of the environment in the country. I never lived in Sweden, but I know that people in Sweden learn how not to show their wealth to other people. And they're real ashamed to demonstrate the fact that they are rich. So their mindset is different. Sweden is rather an exception from the general rule. Globally, people do not behave like people behave in Sweden and other Scandinavian countries. Globally, people try to make as much money and show off, show their wealth. So, if we take Northern Europe, it's different. In Greece, they had lower taxes than in Sweden, and the Greeks were borrowing money from Germany, and out of the borrowed money, they paid high salaries. Same applies to Italy. When Monti started dealing with the issues of taxation, people started dumping their Maserati and Ferrari. They were trying to get rid of them because they didn't know what to do with them. Let's give the floor to Alexander Vladimirovich Bazarov, who is sitting to the left of me. Alexander Vladimirovich, please join our discussion. How should we establish the new catalyst of growth, given our mindset, given our positive and negative experience of the European countries, given that we want to face the problems of small businesses and not to repeat our mistakes of the past? I followed your discussion with great pleasure. I even took notes. So, number one, I, unlike Mikhail, I know Sweden quite well. And I know that Astrid Lindgren, a wonderful writer for children, wrote even another fairy tale in addition to Pippi. So it was the country where the animals, it was inhabited by animals, where the animals paid taxes in excess of 100%. And after this fairy tale was published, the Swedish parliament decided to change the tax system of Sweden. It was about 20 years ago. And the second point that I want to say, we're getting back to Mother Russia. So what should be done here to accelerate economic growth and how to make our lives better? Yesterday, I liked a brief speech by Richard Pipes, a famous Sovietologist, and he was using the word rule of law. What does it mean? What does it really mean? And it means as the following. We know that the Roman Empire existed on the principle of, if you forgot Latin, what is allowed for Jupiter is not allowed for the bull. And the Roman Empire existed for many centuries, but then it collapsed because the bulls did not approve the situation that the rules for them and for Jupiter was so different. So this principle existed in the Russian Empire, and Richard Pipes quoted, this is a quote belongs to Alexander Benkendorf, who said that the laws are written for the subordinates, not for the bosses. So, until we have the laws for the subordinates, not for the bosses, and until we have the two standards of behavior, one for the upper-ups, the other one for those who are beneath, no money will come back to Russia from offshores. No changes are possible. No changes in the legal system will occur because it doesn't matter what is written in the law. Important is how you interpret the law. And as long as the interpretation for the boss and for the subordinate is different, no changes are possible. If the prices for oil are higher, the growth will be higher. If the prices for oil go down, the living standards will go down. If we want to change this model, this approach, we must look at ourselves. And we must not say that somebody else is doing wrong. We should start from ourselves. If you are sweeping the street, you must be the best street sweeper in the world. In dialectics, we never ask this question. If. In dialectics, always and. If we create a climate, an environment which is good only for small and medium-sized business, it will be wrong. For the big corporates only, also bad. We need to create climate for the foreign for the domestic Russian investors, then the foreign investors will join them and will come into the country. The laws are the same for everyone. If I'm not mistaken, when the alarm was on in Sweden, just it was on occasion, the king was delayed in arrival. I cannot imagine such a situation in Russia. So was it Igor Shuvalov who suggested at looking at yourself and to start with yourself? Do not look outside, look inside. Within the framework of the forum, I think this is the most optimistic information for you, or you heard some other things regarding the sources of growth. I like the forum very much, and not because we are the organizers. I liked it because we had very interesting discussions. We discussed the infrastructure and telecommunications and financial industry. We not only scratched the surface, but we were trying to find the ways, the solutions. And in general, I think this was a discussion of equals. There was no hysteria. Everything was very calm and quiet. We all understand the situation. The question is whether we are ready to move forward. If there is a rule of law, I'm totally convinced that we will have the highest rates of economic growth, because Russia has everything for it. We have the territory, we have natural resources, we have people, we have everything that is required for this. And there is optimism, because, yes, 100% of people supported the infrastructure approach. Well, Mr. Pogrodsky, did you want to add something?
Well, there were many things. I will not talk about Sweden. I don't think we can make Russia into Sweden. I think policy must be created in each country based on that country's possibilities. And that's why recipes for Greece designed in Germany fails. And what we do in Sweden is no recipe for anybody else, but maybe it can be some inspiration in some areas, not more. Listening to the discussion about Russia, it feels that everybody agrees that to reform the legal system and the way it is applied is the main hinder for releasing Russia's potential, which everybody also agrees is a fantastic potential. I think, and what to do is quite, if you have agreed to do it, that's a very easy thing. It's not very difficult to create such a system. It's only a matter of will. Do you want to do it or do you not want to do it? If you want to do it, it can be done. It will take time. And after you have done it and it has taken effect, it will take a long time before people trust that it is there and that it will remain. But this is where it stops and this is where it starts. And to design independent courts and to make bosses and juniors have equal treatment, state-owned enterprises and private enterprises, equal treatment in the courts, that's where it is. I'm sure it's as easy as that, or as difficult as that. Thank you.
I liked your wish not to make Sweden out of Russia. When the beginner group, the group of the beginners starts playing rock music and they said, don't do it like Beatles. It's a wrong example. Yes, Mr. Pogrodsky, it's easy for you to give advice for us. We live in a Russian reality and we live here every day. So what particular changes, legal changes are required? What are the rules are required for all and everyone? I do not understand what should be changed in particular. And the question to Ekaterina. So the tragedy of the Russian situation is that we do not have the rule of law. And we are trying to find a solution in a situation when the rule of law will not be fully applied during our lifetime. I'm absolutely convinced that we will not see it during our lives. Yes, of course. Equal attitude to everyone is very important, but there are no little signs of it. Yes, the laws are not so bad, but the execution of the laws starts at the level of courts. And the courts are the zone of special preferences, to put it so. In Moscow, maybe it's not as noticeable as in other regions, but we know that in other regions, the small and medium-sized business is simply fully under control of the local administration. It has to be changed. Why we need to create preferential conditions for small and medium-sized business? Because Gazprom will be able to protect itself in court. But smaller companies need to understand that they have a right, and their rights will be protected. Hence, preferences are necessary for... We do not need to change laws. We need to just observe the laws. Probably that's most important. And in addition, of course, it's a political issue, not a technical issue. And everyone understands this. Maybe it will take decades for everything to get to the level that it is desirable for us today. It's an issue of chicken and egg. We need to develop capitalism, but with the development of capitalism, the rule of law will develop. But in order to develop capitalism, we need to run capitalization, develop infrastructure, take measures to extend the life expectancy of people. And the core problem of Russia now is that the state budget is spent for social project, and it is not enough for building infrastructure in the extent it is needed. If we talk about small business, there is a certain phantom that there is a lot of hurdles to the small business and everybody is oppressing it. I fully disagree with this. Yes, of course there are hurdles, but at the same time there are small businesses who feel themselves very comfortable, they work efficiently. Look at the Moscow restaurants, at the shops, boutiques. But if we move outside of Moscow, 200,000 small enterprises closes because of the changes in the taxation system. But, well, this is true, that's a matter of fact, but... Again, I believe that it's a shortage of infrastructure and segments of the business for the small entrepreneurs to build their operations around. We need to build infrastructure for the small business to develop. Okay, I give the floor to you.
You know what, I'd like to once again refer to the words of Mr. Igor Ivanovich Shuvalov, who was answering a question from the audience. What is it that we can do for you? Someone asked Shuvalov, so that life becomes better. And Shuvalov said, I could only ask you of one thing. Treat other people the way you want other people treated you, according to the Bible. And I fully agree with that. I do think that fundamentally everything in this life has a purpose. Every one of us exists for someone else. Every one of us exists to give something to other people. And what you give away to other people will get back to you, after all. And that's what we try to build our business on, the business of Sberbank. We treat our customers as the main people for us in the bank. And recently I made a discovery. Sberbank is the only bank in the world where there is a monument to the bank's first customer standing in the yard of the headquarters. If we treat our customers like that, that will make the change. That will make the difference. Thank you, everybody. But finally, as we were talking about the second topic, the catalyst of growth could be Russia and Europe getting closer, because we both are in a difficult situation, equally difficult situation. Could we identify a catalyst for that? Alexei Kudrin before said it wouldn't be just one idea, internet or electricity, it would be more than one idea. But would you identify several such ideas like now? Please do it in turn, Mr. Bagrotsky, you would be the first one, would you?
Well, the Western European crisis is a political crisis. It's created by European politicians, and European people suffer as a result. There is a shortage of demand in a region with a current account surplus and no inflation. That should not be the case. Politicians in Western Europe should add to demand by rebalancing austerity and stimulus. Then demand can start growing, and that will benefit all in Europe, including Russia. And then we should cooperate more to integrate our economies by having the same regulatory standards, by facilitating for business people to make contracts across the border, legal systems, technical standards, environmental standards, food and health standards, all these boring details that give no politician the headlines on the front page, but means so much for the daily work of normal business people. That's what we should focus on.
Да, Екатерина, прошу вас.
Human capital must be in the focus of new development now. Today, after the energy is going to the background, the country must create conditions where human capital is really worthy, is considered to be worthy, and is to be valued and maintained. And enterprises who create value by their use of human capital, they should be in the focus of the economic policy. Mikhail Valerievich, I agree with Ekaterina about human capital. Conditions must be created where people would be willing to earn money, and they would understand that the political system stimulates them for that rather than punishing them for becoming richer. And in terms of practical steps, I wouldn't say anything for Europe. I know too little to give any recipe, but in Russia, I'm convinced privatization is number one. Accelerated privatization. The state should not be the owner of property except that which is of strategic importance for the nation. Then curb inflation, and finally, and the main instrument to curb inflation is slowing down of energy prices in the first place, natural gas in the first place, because that's the main driver of energy prices, of prices going up, and a whole set of measures aiming at improving the life expectancy of people and health status of the people. The government has been doing something about that, and the figures look positive now, but the more the better there. And the filling of the national budget with taxes, not through increasing the personal income tax or corporate taxes, but increasing the taxes on consumption, luxury goods consumption in the first place. Well, it looks like a philosophical discussion that we've had here. So my advice would be, the main problem is demography in this country. As long as we treat people as population, that problem cannot possibly be resolved. And we need to start to treat people as customers, every one of us to everyone else. Then we will be able to address the demographic problem, and everything will be fine. And things are not that bad here, after all. Thank you. This was Opinions at Russia 24. Thank you.